Father, we thank you for your grace, for all of the things that grace brings to us, Lord. We thank you that grace of God that brings salvation. It has appeared unto all men, the same grace, Lord, has even made it possible for us to even walk worthy and pleasing to you, even after we receive eternal life. Father, we thank you also for the grace that enables us, Lord, to fulfill the call that you have placed upon us. Lord, we believe that serving you, living for you, and ministering to others, Lord, is the highest call that we can make, that we can make. Father, we thank you because we have received your strength of the fullness we have received and grace upon grace. We thank you for every good, every perfect gift. All are from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is no darkness, neither shadow of turning. Father, we thank you that you are the strength of our life. You are the light of our salvation. We are complete in you. And Lord, of the fullness we have received, and grace upon grace. Lord, your grace is sufficient, even this evening, glory. Every blessing, every gift, everything that you have provided us, and make that reality in our lives. Lord, you stand behind your word. Your word is forever settled in heaven. Your word will never go void of power. It will always accomplish the purpose that you have sent it to do. And it will always prosper in the thing whereunto it is said. Thank you for the word of God. Lord, it is the inches of the word give life. It give understanding to the simple. Lord, and the word of God give life to all of them that find it, healing to all of our flesh. Father, we thank you. We bow our knees to you. And we ask you, Lord, to give us the spirit of wisdom so that we might know the hope of your calling and seated greatness of your power toward us, Lord, and the exceeding riches of inheritance that you have blessed us with. Lord, we have all received an inheritance. Everything that pertains unto life and unto godliness, Lord, we have received that. Everything that pertains to our blessings in heavenly places, spiritual blessings, Lord, we have received. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Thank you for beginning the good work within us. And you who have begun the good work within us, you shall continue to perform. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody just say in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, I got some good news for you tonight. God's grace is sufficient. God's grace is sufficient. He's able to cause all grace to abound toward us, so we will have sufficiency in everything. All right. Okay, I want to start out tonight by getting y'all involved. And, y'all been itching to talk, I know. Y'all been itching to talk, so I got some good questions. But last week I mentioned about, we were speaking about saving grace, standing grace, which is grace which enables us to stand victorious in this life. And we were also mentioning about serving grace. And I gave an illustration of standing grace. And the illustration I gave was, y'all might remember this, that in heaven, they were discussing, these were after people, after those that died and went on. Many of them were sinners that were saved on their deathbed, some very vile people, people with nasty backgrounds. They all made it to heaven by the way of their deathbed experience. And a lot of times, people at the last moment, they live terrible lives. They have nasty backgrounds, but when they feel that their time is about over, they what? They turn to the Lord. So, I guess somebody says better later, late than never. So the discussion in heaven went like this, that they were trying to determine out of all of these people with all of this, these bad backgrounds, who would be the greatest example of God's grace. In other words, the greatest demonstration of God's grace was the thing that they were discussing. All right, so the murderer and the thief and the whoremongers and all of the people, serial killers. Y'all don't believe that in heaven that there will be people with history of sin, of being a serial killer. People with all types of sins that at some point in their life they experienced a transformation and God saved them and God delivered them. So all of these people were thinking that it had to be one of these persons with these terrible, terrible, terrible backgrounds that would be the greatest demonstration of God's grace. And they were almost at the point of selecting the person that had done the most sins, the one that did a little bit of everything. Y'all know anybody like that? Did a little bit of, you know, sometimes we don't be guilty of a whole lot of different sins. Sometimes we just had our certain sins. You know, certain things that we just really like. And not just everything in the book. All right. But they were about to decide on the fellow that had done everything in the book. And he had the nastiest, probably, record of all of those that were there. They were just about ready to decide on this person. Until one young man stood up and decided to give his testimony. And his testimony was that he came to know the Lord at a very early age and never really got involved in a whole lot of the things that all of the others were guilty of. In other words, he didn't have that bad of a background. Of course, all have sinned, you know that, and come short of the glory of God, but he didn't have a history of all of these dirty sins and nasty sins and all of these variety of sins that many of the others had. So after he told his story, then they voted just to see who would be the greatest demonstration of God's grace among the young man who received the Lord at an early age. And he never got involved, you know, in a whole lot of sins like all of the others. Of course, he did sin because after you reach the age of accountability and know right from wrong, sin is imputed against you, right? Okay, so when the vote was taken, it was not the liar, the murderer, the serial killer, and all of the people that rape children, you call them pedophiles? It wasn't any of them, and they finally, everybody voted that this young man that had come to know the Lord when he was very young, he never got all of these sins, but he was able to avoid a whole lot of all of these sins that most of them were guilty of. He didn't have a nasty background, but yet he received the vote. They voted him as being the greatest demonstration of God's grace. I want y'all to tell me, why do you consider that as God's greatest demonstration of his grace, rather than those that with the nasty backgrounds? Now, if you know, the people with the nasty background, they're the only ones that's invited to come, you know, on the evangelistic circle. You know, they don't want everybody want to hear. They don't want to hear nobody just nice and, you know, all their life. They ain't done a whole lot of stuff.
So why do you feel that a person that was able to avoid most of these things that all of the others were guilty of in their lifetime, why do you feel that he was chosen to be the greatest monument of God's grace? All right, I want y'all to talk on that because I want to get a point. Boom. All right, sister?
Because for one thing, he listened to God. He listened to the word of God, and he believed the word of God, and he obeyed the word of God. And in doing that, in whatever situation he was in, obviously he had enough power from that living word in him to resist the many temptations.
All right, Sister Barbara, that was good. All right, Sister Barbara, that was hit a home run. I want somebody else to expound on that. All right, anybody else? How many would have voted for the young man that was never into the dirty, the nasty? I mean, all sins are but there are some sins which society deems as a lot more what? Wicked than others. And a lot of sins you do will get you into trouble, where a lot of sins won't. I mean, all of them will get you in trouble with God, but as far as society is concerned, there's a whole lot of things that we do that nobody know about, right? but God sees the heart, but society sins that they will judge you. For instance, like if you has a reputation for being, for instance, like if you are in a, there are some sins of society, for instance, like that, I understand in prison, though the child molesters, they say that they are really the target for a whole lot of the prisoners there.
Sure.
Even they, Sister Irene, is that right?
Yeah, they use a lot of time to put the DC protective custody.
All right. Sister Irene knows about it. All right, that's good. All right, so anybody else want to expound on that before we go further? Now let's look at God's grace in terms of keeping a person after they get saved and protecting them or guiding them or leading them in a way where they never really succumb to a whole lot of sins that people normally succumb to. Okay, so what could you say about that when, like Sister Barbara said, that person that's exposed to the word, maybe he came up in the environment where people were sincere, they were devout, there was a greater fear of God, and there was a greater degree of teaching, and maybe good examples were before him. So therefore, he never got drawn into a whole lot of sin, because I know a whole lot of churches teach that once you're born again, then there are some things that you definitely have to do in order to receive God's grace to stand victorious. You know, you got to come out from among people that are engaging in sin. You're not to build intimate relationships with them, right? And you are also, you to shun the very what? Appearance of evil. You know, some churches teach things like that. But some churches teach resist temptation, flee fornication, and have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness, but what? Reprove them. So some churches really teach holiness and sanctification, and where people teach, where they those doctrines are taught and talk with convictions and people really embrace them, then you're going to have a greater degree of grace released into that environment to keep you from what? Sinning and following the example that a whole lot of people that don't have that type of exposure have. Okay. Is that it? Okay. Why don't you hit your hand?
No. I do have something.
Because I was raised in a holiness church, but I don't consider myself as being. I know we were permitted to go to movies, and we didn't go to word of stuff. We didn't go to word of stuff. You have to watch the ball game. We have to watch stuff like that. There were certain things that we were kind of instructed not to do. And so from an early age, we grew up with strong convictions. And, of course, we get out of devilment, although we were raising. But the bold stuff, we didn't even, we would never go there, the bold stuff. But we were sinners like everybody else, because I was 21 before I even gave my life to God. I was stubborn and full of pride, and I wouldn't praise the Lord. I never felt the power of God raised up in the holiness church. I never felt the power of God one time. Every altar service they had, they tried to get you there. But I just didn't have no mind to serve the Lord, even though I was raised in a holiness church. But yet I have this conviction that certain things you didn't do because you would go to hell for it. And so that kind of was a rule of thumb. So yet I sinned. And I was guilty of a whole lot of things, but not like a lot of the sins that we see today, in which people are sent to the pen for, or prison for, or people that are sentenced to die in the electric chair for. We never even considered things like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was just thinking about the question that you asked. Mm-hmm. I remember Sister Barbara. Mm-hmm. And also the statement you made. Mm-hmm. I was thinking about it. I guess another question could be asked is the young man that hadn't done as much was a testament to God's keeping.
Mm-hmm. Keeping power.
Mm-hmm. But yet, on the other hand, mm-hmm. the one that had the vile record mm-hmm. was a testimony of God's saving grace. Mm-hmm. So you have to ask yourself, which one is more powerful? I think they both, the saving grace as well as his keeping grace. I was thinking about Apostle Paul. Mm-hmm. He was probably just as vile as, I don't know, mm-hmm. the person that you were speaking of. Mm-hmm. But look how God saved him. Mm-hmm. And look, to me, that was a great monument mm-hmm. of faith, mm-hmm. of what he became. Mm-hmm. Perhaps there were other people living during his era, just like the young man that they voted to be the greatest testimony of faith. Mm-hmm. We don't read about that, mm-hmm. but we hear about Apostle Paul. Mm-hmm. So I guess the question is, which one is the more weightier? Mm-hmm. Are they equal? Mm-hmm. Is keeping grace or the saving grace?
All right. Is keeping grace or the saving grace? Which is... which one would y'all feel that is more significant? God's saving grace or God's keeping grace? Anybody can talk.
I think they're both important, equally as important. Mm-hmm. I don't think you can say one's more important than the other. Depends on which one you need.
Mm-hmm. That's true. All right, depends on which one you need. All right, so God's saving grace is equally available to all, right? Mm-hmm. Everybody can receive whatever extent of saving grace that you need, because God's saving grace has been made available equally to what? Everybody. Mm-hmm. Everybody can receive God's what?
Saving grace.
saving grace, because it's God's will for every man, every person to be what? Saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Mm-hmm. All right, so what about God's keeping grace? Is that equally as available to all as saving grace is? All right. All right, everybody say yes?
I said no.
Okay, all right, give us a reason.
And my reason is you have to be saved first to be kept. Mm-hmm. So without saving, how can you be kept?
Mm-hmm. All right, so after you're saved, God's keeping grace equally is available to all. Right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's, you know, you can't be kept until you're saved. But God's keeping grace is equally available, what, to all after you are what? Saved. Right? Okay. Now, what aspect of God's grace is not equally available to all?
Serving grace.
Which one?
Serving and ministry grace.
Or serving grace or ministry grace. All right, because Paul's ministry was different from all of the other apostles' ministry. Mm-hmm. Now, who was the one who had the revelation of Christ in you, the hope of glory? Who had the revelation of the righteous, we are the righteousness of God? Christ has become now. All of these major doctrines that enable us to live and overcome in life were doctrines that God revealed to the Apostle Paul. And remember that he was down in Damascus. Is that right? Not Damascus. He was down in Arabia 3 years after his conversion. And he was just waiting for God to reveal Christ in him. So he had a greater revelation. And he had a greater anointing. And therefore, he accomplished a whole lot more than what all of the others. About two-thirds of the New Testament probably was written by Paul. Okay, so he had a greater anointing. And you're going to have, in ministry, you're going to have the fivefold ministry gifts, right? The apostle is going to have what? More anointing and more grace, more than likely, than what? The pastor or teacher. Right?
Yeah.
And so you're going to have different dimensions of grace in the arena of God's serving grace or God's ministering grace. All right. I want to focus a little bit, and I want y'all to do the talking tonight, on keeping grace. Okay, now what components are going to have to be in place in order for God to really perfect an individual or give them the ability to live victoriously in their walk with him? What are some of the components that's going to have to be in place for God's grace to really work successfully in the life of those that's saved and they need to be kept by the power of God? What components need to be in place? What is going to keep us walking victoriously?
A desire to be kept. And
okay.
You have to have a knowledge.
Okay. Okay, we have desire to be kept. Then somebody said the knowledge.
The language.
Mm-hmm.
I think 2 Peter 1 and 3 through 10 says it encompasses all.
All right. Okay, Sister Hill says she's got a revelation here.
No, not a revelation. It's just a scripture.
Well,
it's not my
revelation. It's man there. It's,
okay.
All right, you
want to
expound on that?
Well, let's see.
Can everybody hear you, Hero?
Yeah. Let's see what verse we start. I guess we need to start at 3. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, haven't escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Here we go. And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue, knowledge, and to knowledge, temperance, and to temperance, patience, and to patience, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind, and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sin. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, here's the key. Give diligence to making your to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall.
Okay, you want to elaborate on it? You read a whole lot.
This is acceptable. If you do these things, you will never fall.
Okay.
And you got to add to it.
Okay, the first virtue.
You got to do something, then you add to that, then you add to
the. Okay, what's the first thing you get? What's the first thing you start out with?
You got to have knowledge.
Okay, add to your faith what?
You got to have knowledge.
All right, how do you get your faith?
Like you and they coming by here.
All right, so initially, in order to get into the grace of God, you got to hear the word, right? Mm-hmm. You got to hear the word. The gospel has to be what? Preached. Everybody agree with that?
Yeah.
The gospel has to be preached before you can even come in to the arena of grace. Mm-hmm. All right, saving grace, I would say. Okay. Now, after you're saved, what's the first virtue that he says add? Add to your faith what?
Virtue, knowledge.
All right, God deals to every one of us the major of what? Faith. Mm-hmm. Once we hear the word, then God gives us the ability to what? To believe and to what? And to receive. Mm-hmm. So he deals to us the major of faith, okay? Add to your faith what?
Virtue.
Virtue. What is virtue?
Moral excellence.
All right, now why does it start with moral excellence?
Because you need to turn away from those things that are not of God.
Mm-hmm. All right, so Sister Irene is saying that you won't even get to first base if you don't turn away from those ungodly things. Mm-hmm. So the call is to what? Come out from among the world and all of your what? Association with the world, all of the unfruitful works of darkness. You have to what? Separate yourself from all of these things in order to what? To really move ahead in God. Mm-hmm. All right, now, name some scriptures where the Bible put a lot of emphasis on being pure. Okay, Sister Hill just read it. After your faith, virtue, moral, excellence.
Okay,
and I want to know why being pure is so important to knowledge and
understanding.
Okay, so. All right, everybody can hear up here?
Romans 12:1.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So we have to present our bodies.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so God calls for separation. So you have to change your environment in order to what? Receive. He says that if you don't come out from the worldly environment, your worldly friends, and the works of darkness, he says, I can't even what? Receive you. In other words, I can't what? I can't really minister to you. I can't really fellowship with you. The Bible says have nothing to do with the unfruitful what? Works of darkness. So in order to get any degree of life and understanding and revelation or direction are straight from God, you have to what? You have to separate yourself from what things that's going to what hinder you from being what? From receiving from God. There's a scripture which says that there's no fellowship with what? Darkness and light. All right? So God is looking for people that have what? Actually what? Separated themselves or detached themselves. Because that's the stipulations that we must meet in order for God to really to work in you and for God to what? Direct your life. And for God to reveal things to you. All right, so that's the first. Now, there's a scripture. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they what? There's a lot of emphasis on being pure. Anybody have anything, just feel free how important it is to be pure. All right, y'all speak up. Yes.
I like Philippians 4 and 8. Mm-hmm. It says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever thing are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. So if I got some crazy stuff that's going on in my mind, if I think on the good things of God and Scripture, that's where I'm going to get the power to keep doing what I need to do in God. You can't just stop thinking about this stuff. You got to replace it with the Word of God. Mm-hmm. You got to make an effort on your own self to replace your thinking mm-hmm. with the Word of God.
Okay, read that scripture again.
Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, mm-hmm. if there be any virtue, mm-hmm. and if there be any praise, think on these things. And that word good report, it can be pronounced good report. Mm-hmm. So if I gotta be willing to stop thinking about all the drama. And the only way to get away from that drama is with the Word of God mm-hmm. and praising Him. Mm-hmm. And you can't praise the Lord and be thinking about all this other junk.
All right, good. Now, we'll open this up to Barbara. She's our starter, isn't it? All right. I'm open for any discussion on the importance of purity and holiness in your walk with the Lord. Why is that a prerequisite for spiritual perfection?
It says in 1 Timothy 4:12 that's how you are an example of the believers. It says, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, and in purity.
Okay, be thou an example. And purity is in there, what else? Your words,
conversation,
your lifestyle,
charity,
in spirit,
in faith,
okay.
In purity.
Okay, why is that example is so important to follow? Why is that type of an example is so important for a believer to follow? It says, be thou an example in all of these things. Why is that so important?
Well, number one, they're representing it. And then, secondly, other people are observing, and sometimes your life, what they observe, mm-hmm. is all in the book they're going to read, mm-hmm. your life. Mm-hmm. So it's important that you would be a representative of what the word is.
Right. Okay, so anybody can remember, anybody in the Bible that that was guilty of a bad example and it really impacted a whole lot of people? A person that was really renowned in the Bible that had a bad example and it really impacted a lot of people.
David.
All right, who was that?
David.
Okay, how did he impact so many people?
His family. All his children.
All right, all of his children were impacted. And all of them ended up experiencing pretty well some type of what? Disastrous end because of that example that was set. Now, what kind of example did it set in Israel? And the nations that inherited of David's sin that were idolatrous. They gave them an occasion, what, to speak evil of what? The things of God. So that's one of the reasons why you want to be a good example, because when people see the wrong example, then they're going to what? They're going to put everybody in the same what? Bag. They're going to say everybody's wicked, everybody's a fraud, everybody are hypocrites. And none of those people are what? Are living right. That's the danger of being a bad example. You can cause a lot of people to speak evil of something that's good. You're not going to ever find, you know, if there weren't any counterfeit, like, if that weren't any real money, it couldn't be any what?
Counterfeit.
So it's got to be what? Some real in order to have what?
Counterfeit.
All right, so everybody in every church ain't going to be what, right? We have a whole lot of people that will be doing stuff. But it doesn't take away from the fact that there's somebody in that church, more than likely, that's what? Really living for God.
That's right.
All right, okay. Now, I'm hoping for the priority that the Bible places on holiness, and I'm going to just give you something that probably you never have thought about, but scriptures like Psalms 24, verses 3 and 5, you might want to turn there, but that's an Old Testament scripture that goes a long way. But this is Psalms 24, verses 3 and 5. Okay, 24, 3 and 5. Somebody read it for me.
Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
Who shall stand in his holy place?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and skip down to 5.
Mm-hmm.
He shall receive the blessing from the Lord, the righteousness from the God of
okay,
the Son.
Okay, he had clean hands, is that right?
That's 4. You
okay.
Said 3 and 5.
Yeah, 4. Okay. Mm-hmm.
He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully.
Okay, so those are the ones that can, that are able to what?
It says, and those are the ones that shall receive the blessings from the Lord,
mm-hmm.
and righteousness from the God of his salvation.
Okay, what about those that's, that can maintain fellowship? In other words, in order to maintain fellowship with God, how many feel like maintaining fellowship with God? It's important. All right, y'all sure we go there.
Absolutely. Amen.
Okay. All right. The Bible says that if we walk in the light as what? He is in the light. Then we have what? Fellowship. One with another. And the blood of Jesus, God's Son, will cleanse us from what? From all sin. So in other words, to maintain fellowship with God, you have to walk in the light. You have to walk in all of the truth or all of the light that you know.
Yes.
So that's the only way that you can live a life that's what void of all what comes in. You can't live a life pleasing to God and always have a guilty conscience.
That's right.
Scripture says there is therefore what now? No condemnation to them which are what? In Christ Jesus, who walk not after the vote. I'm going to say that. All right, now, there is a scripture. Okay, let's turn to the one that we probably should have read at first, 2 Corinthians 6:14. And this is the scripture that all holiness churches, all full gospel churches, really lean very heavily on when they are admonishing their people to really live a holy life. And many times people have heard the scripture, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall what?
See the Lord.
So that's a prerequisite for what seeing the Lord. All right, now let's look at 2 Corinthians 6:14. Somebody read that for me.
Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Mm-hmm. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness?
Mm-hmm.
And what communion hath light with darkness?
Okay, let's just stop there. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now how can you obey that when you're working around unbelievers every day? And you are connected with unbelievers every time you go out, every time you shop, and every time you work, every time you go to school, you are connected with what? Unbelievers. And then the scripture says, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? All right, I want to hear from somebody on that.
Yoke to me means more of an attachment.
Yeah.
So it's more of a personal relationship.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's different than being friendly or social, mm-hmm. as in passive, mm-hmm. and have an intimate relationship, or not only just male and female,
mm-hmm.
but a close relationship with a female that you know is living on your life.
All right. This is the prophetess.
Or it can mean, it can mean something like a covenant, like I remember saying something like a covenant, if you're in partner. Business partnership,
mm-hmm.
with an unsaved person,
mm-hmm.
that wouldn't be such a good idea. And if you are saved before you get married,
mm-hmm.
you would marry an unsaved person, because that's a covenant,
mm-hmm.
and that's not a good relationship.
Mm-hmm. All right, so this refers to intimate what ties and connections between what people that are what saved and people that are what unsaved.
Right, because you cannot avoid being in a workplace and around, mm-hmm. people that are, you know, certain places you can't avoid. And it's kind of like Sister Irene, Sister Pearl was saying, yoke and me is put together. And I was thinking of when the scripture was read,
mm-hmm.
when two oxen are yoked together,
mm-hmm.
or two horses,
mm-hmm.
my grandfather used to, I remember, used to plow with them, they were together.
Mm-hmm.
And when he pulled those strings and he said, they both stopped and they both would go,
mm-hmm.
a certain language he would use, they were yoked together.
Mm-hmm.
And but unless you are, you know, connected intimately with someone else, that doesn't mean that you're yoked together if you're just in that environment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because there were other horses around. They were yoked together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but those two were yoked together.
Mm-hmm.
And he would say, gee, they'd go to the right hard, they'd go to the left.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they were connected.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. Very
and
good.
So if two married people is married, not saved when they married, one gets saved, so they didn't get a divorce because they are unyoked?
No.
No.
All right. Sister, well, I think you can answer that.
No. Well, she asked a question.
All right.
She wanted to answer.
Oh, she just wanted to figure it out, so.
You said you wanted to answer.
All right, so. Say it again.
I said, but
two
people are married. They're not saved when they get married.
Okay, they're not saved when they get married.
Nope.
Two people get married. They're not saved, okay?
One gets saved.
One gets saved.
And the other don't.
The other one doesn't. All right, then. Do they get a divorce?
No.
All right, so who can get that straight now?
You have to believe God for that person to be saved. You have a righteous life before them. Ask God to bless them to get saved also, but you've already married in. I mean, you don't just free us, oh, well, you know. You have to stand for God to do something about that.
Yeah, in the word it says that the wife can give the unsaved ones her husband's name. You know, she lives a righteous life.
Mm-hmm. But they have to be a good example, right?
Right, yes.
They have to be godly. They got to be, you know, strong and prayerful. And they got to have the right to be the right example.
The Bible don't tell you how long that's going to take, though.
Sure does.
Because, I mean, I know people say it took 20 years.
20 years.
Okay. All right. Well, that's right. It might take 20 years.
One woman
disrespect. One thing about it, that's, it takes 20 years. Somebody's going to be real strong, you know?
Yes, amen.
Right?
Strong or even weak.
Girl, girl. But, you know, the Bible doesn't force you to stay together if certain circumstances exist in the relationship. You have to have some knowledge of God and wisdom of God in order to know how far to go in a relationship, and sometimes separation might be necessary.
And the Bible speaks about that separation.
Right, right. Okay. All right, so the Bible.
Sometimes when people get saved, they get so self-righteous that their worst act, their behavior seems worse after they got saved than before they got saved. So then that's another situation.
Well, I'm going from the deep end, huh? Somebody want to do Super Salad? Holy Joe. Scott Pizer. That can cause some problems in the relationship.
That kind of behavior repels rather than attracts.
Right. That keeps the spouse from getting saved.
You said they might run for you, huh?
Yeah. All right, let me give y'all another scenario, because what about people that say my call is going into the clubs preaching the gospel and getting people saved in the clubs?
No.
All right, anybody feel that you can go to a club after you get saved and really come out unscathed.
I would say if a person was saved, if they had a background like that, you know, being involved in that kind of thing before they got saved, that's a temptation that one does not need. Mm-hmm. However, if a person never had that, and God sends them there, they can go in and witness. God has to send them and come out of the game.
That's right.
Cecilia, they got to know that it's God that
sends them. Absolutely. They got to know that it's God.
All right, Brother Madison, God bless you. He was here early tonight.
I see you, man.
So he has a right to leave before we all do.
It's time to go anyway.
I like it. He was driving up. He said, "I can't wait for my family. They're too slow." Okay.
But I have seen one instance of back home. This church that I was going to, there was some new converts that, you know, started going to church and gotten saved. And one of the sisters had heard that they was in the club, and a few of the sisters, they went there in the club to go get that person and to bring them out. I have seen that instance when they went in there and told them, you know, hey, you know.
Don't need to be in
there. Yeah, so they went there in the club. They got them and brought them out.
Yeah,
Okay. Pastor, I think you do have to be very, very careful with that.
Right.
But you have to know what your calling is, as Brother Travis said. But if you want to try to save alcoholics, you're going to have to smell some alcohol. And so you have to be very careful, and you got to know where you stand, and you have to be called to do that, to perform that sort of thing.
So you have a special grace.
Right.
Yeah. Jesus, he
expression of grace, but I don't think you have.
And I don't think that you have to necessarily go in the club to minister to alcoholic if that's your call. So I mean, that don't mean God gonna see you in a club, but He may send you to talk to some people if you have been an alcoholic yourself and the minister them you got saved. But usually, I would think there would be a time period that you have been saved for a while and sober for a while for God to use you in ministry, because you could be a good example.
Right. All right, now what about this? Don't let your evil
be evil for good. Amen. That's right.
Showing the very appearance of evil.
Well, I think that's what Sister, she was talking about, that the saints, because Sister Caress,
one of the newcomers was in the club, and they went to go
together.
To get them.
Because it was probably thinking that what she was doing was probably, well, I don't know what she was doing, but maybe she had good intentions, but her good could be
his. And this influence is going to be confronting a lot of our kids, which are in these schools. So, how are kids, Christian kids that really have values, how are they going to be able to stand up against all of this influence where everybody is going? And before long, the whole country is going to be more for that than against it.
You don't have to fall for that. You don't have to fall for that. Mm-hmm. You know, it depends on what your convictions are. I say, you know, you can, if your convictions are strong, you don't have to be influenced by that. Mm-hmm. You really don't. It, you know, what your convictions are and how deeply the word, how you have internalized the word. And you could, like, I could be around alcohol all day. It wouldn't bother me one bit because I never had a problem with that, never drank. And it wouldn't influence me. So then.
Well, how long you been saved, though?
Many years. But
how much work have you heard?
A lot. But still, even with that, I think a person. He's trying to put me on trial.
But it's going to be different from people that. They haven't been under the teaching you have. They haven't been saved as long. They probably don't have the convictions because churches years ago that we came up under, they had, you know, no different convictions. We had good examples and all of that. So I think that this is a different environment that we're in today, and that a lot of children probably can't specifically turn to the scripture and turn to the word and find a scripture that says that.
You know, there's some people that came up in the church and you know the church all their lives and still fall for things. I mean, some things are, some people are just going to be swayed. I used to tell my daughter all the time, be a leader and not a follower, and know which way you lead. Because you can even lead wrong. Mm-hmm. Going wrong, you're still going wrong. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think it's just so hard to say who's going to fall and who's going to be moved to what spirit, because those are spirits.
Mm-hmm. Well, how many feel that whether you're going to give in or cave is it's a personal issue, because maybe you just inherit in you is a weakness, inclination to succumb to temptations. How much do you think the person's exposure to truth and their commitment to reading the word and prayer and things of that nature contributes to it? I think that for people to be weak, giving in, sometimes it's not just something inherent in them, but sometimes it's their commitment to read, to listen. You know, sometimes we be teaching them about things in here, and maybe some pay attention and some don't.
Sometimes
be careful how you hear. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's really important for our children to be not only instructed at church, but we need to share with them even at home and read to them the
things that are plaguing the nation today, things that a lot of the political issues that's going on, which are contrary to the Word of God, I think it's important for us to what? To point to these things and to share with them things like 1 Corinthians 6:9 that we did last week. Okay, now these are things that we're going to have to get over to our children, because I know even in circles that I have been in Church of God in Christ, holiness, full gospel.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's kind of like you said earlier. Mm-hmm. Take you for an example. Mm-hmm. You grew up in the Church of God in Christ. You were exposed to the Word. You mm-hmm. said it didn't impact you mm-hmm. until you heard about the death sentence you thought was here mm-hmm. being pronounced on you. Well, for some people, that they hear the Word, they've been taught the Word, they know it, but they don't act on it until a tragedy, if they think an impending tragedy is about to happen. And then they'll get serious about it. So it could be a sexual sin, it could be any number of things mm-hmm. that people can hear the Word mm-hmm. and hear it over and over and over again, and it doesn't impact them mm-hmm. Until they really feel mm-hmm. that something impending is about to happen.
Okay, very good, very good. I mean, we have a pretty good discussion. Now, I want somebody to, like young people, when they are in the environment where kids are saying things, or they are...
That's a signal, too.
They are really beginning to engage in things which are really ungodly. What things should young people be aware of so that they will know that maybe this person shouldn't be my friend? I shouldn't have this close relationship with them. I shouldn't be around them and listen to all of these things. Now, what kind of things should they be aware of when they are with their friends? Because very few parents are teaching their kids now a lot of these things that we are hearing tonight. Okay, what kind of things should they be aware of when they are around their friends? So they'll know that the Bible says that they're not to develop what? Close relationships with people that are going in a different direction, people that have different values, people that have been, you know, that don't live a certain lifestyle. Okay, what are some of the things that we should be aware of in order to tell our children, to let them know?
I would say personally that, you know, we're living in a society where there's a difference in the kingdom of God and the kingdom of this world. Mm-hmm. And we're living in actually two different worlds. Mm-hmm. I mean, Christians are living in the kingdom of God, mm-hmm. but you have the ungodly who's living in yeah. the kingdom of this world. Right. So there's a distinction. Mm-hmm. And the gap is being widened now, where it's pretty evident if a person would understand if they want to be in the kingdom of God, mm-hmm. they want to be in the kingdom of mm-hmm. The God of this world. Mm-hmm. So in relationship, because we know that's an abomination mm-hmm. in the kingdom mm-hmm. of God. Mm-hmm. So it shows a difference of disparity on which kingdom you're going to belong to. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not going to be any mm-hmm. straddling the fence anymore. Mm-hmm. You're either going to know if you're from the kingdom of God or from the kingdom of the God of this world, mm-hmm. which is Satan. Mm-hmm. So I think they need to seek first ye the kingdom mm-hmm. of heaven.
Okay.
They got to seek it.
So how are young people contaminated?
When they born.
How are they contaminated? In other words, sometimes they might have, you know, pretty good values. They've heard a lot, but a lot of times these values are begin to erode.
It's the community mind. It's the mind. It's a good mind.
When they're born, they're contaminated. If you don't catch it between the ages of 0 to 7 years old, their pattern of life is almost set at the age of 7. Because nowadays, back in the day when the child was born, they didn't open their eyes for 6 weeks, maybe a month. They come out with their eyes open, walking and crawling, and So they're contaminated the day they're born. Mm-hmm. And if you don't get something instilled in them from 0 to 7 years old, you kind of lost that bond in a way. Mm-hmm. And they're saying that they can't be taught. But they have found out another way. If you let the TV raise them, the neighbor raise them, the radio raise them, at 5, they're going to be living on the other side of the fence.
Okay, now how many understand the reason why God tells us to come out from the world and get away from their values and intimate contacts and the close relationships and marrying? You know, in the Old Testament, the Israelites were forbidden to marry what? Our people of other nations. Because, you know, of the idolatry thing.
They were told the reason why we don't want you intermarrying is because you could take on their customs.
Right.
And that was the reason why.
They would take on their customs, their ways, their lives.
And that's usually what happens.
It's a group mindset. Mm-hmm. It's a worldly mindset.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because the world is going to promote its own. Mm-hmm. And God has to promote his own. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, each mindset, you're either going to gear your mind toward a certain standard, mm-hmm. but it's a mindset, mm-hmm. a worldly mindset. Right. If you get into a group, mm-hmm. it's been proven that group mindsets is able to persuade people if they're not strong in their convictions.
Good. All right, very good. Okay.
Folks in media have become a two-edged sword in our society. It works. It has great benefits, and it has great sorrows.
Right.
It works for us, and it works against us. Just to give you a good example, with the Boston bombing.
Right.
It didn't take the FBI and all of them no time to use that social network.
That's right.
You know, to locate those guys there and find them. Mm-hmm. But it was the same network that put in those two boys' heads mm-hmm. in just a matter of weeks to do what they did. Mm-hmm. You know, it's working more against us mm-hmm. than it is for us. Mm-hmm. And it's a great avenue for the devil mm-hmm. to do his work. Mm-hmm. And they have more access to that. Mm-hmm. You know, our children do than they do to us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now what about coming to church, we put in these good morals and virtues and principles in them, and then they go on the internet, and then they pick up a whole lot of stuff that erodes a whole lot of the things that we teach.
That's exactly what's happening.
Okay. All right, so that means that all of us, the younger generation, they're going to have to get a foundation started for themselves, and they're going to have to be taught that it's important for them to what? Be established on a what? A good solid spiritual foundation. That means that they're going to have to what? Read the Bible. I don't know how you get the young people to do that, because everything else is a lot more interesting than the Bible.
Well, you know, it's for the young people and for us, you can't hold them stupid. I think is a good example of that, and that's a prodigal son. They both were reared in the same household. Mm-hmm. You both were taught. Mm-hmm. We know, everybody in here probably knows the story of how the one went away with his righteous living mm-hmm. and all that. Mm-hmm. And when he had wasted all of his substance, mm-hmm. then he says, you know, I'm going back to my father. Mm-hmm. He went back to where he came from, mm-hmm. you know, but didn't he have the word when he left? He had as much as the brother that stayed. Mm-hmm. You know, they've been taught the same, but he chose to go another direction, but he also chose to come back. And sometimes that's what has to happen to people after they've been taught and they choose to go one direction. That word is in them. Mm-hmm. But if they stray, you know, they could choose to come back.
Yeah. All right, Mary, then we're going to have to close. Sister Barbara, you were...
Okay, just to touch upon what Sister Neal is saying, this scripture we all know, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. So this is the way I see it. Those people that they're under our care, Just keep presenting it to them in different forms. Just keep doing it. Well, all we can do is present it. I don't necessarily mean preach it, but maybe a pretty silent praise and worship song playing in the background where you don't hear the words. I mean, just all kinds of things that you can do that puts that word in that child. And we just have to be diligent in what we present and what our standards are and what we're willing to do to help them get saved. And then they may be in an uncomfortable situation even. But we just got to stick with what thus saith the Lord to us.
All right, very good.
We have one announcement.
All right. Just before we announce that Colossians and Ephesians, they are two books that deals with the how to, what to do, what not to do, in order to receive God's grace. See, God, he has abundance of grace, but the grace won't kick in until we understand how the game of grace is played. You know, God has all this grace, but there are certain things that we have to do in order for us to be placed in a position for this grace to reach us,
yes,
for us to get the benefit of it.
No,
so I think it would be good for us to really begin a revival. Y'all hear me? A revival of reading the Word.
Okay.
Everybody understand that? A revival.
Amen.
All right, revival.
I'm not saying.
I'm observing those saying that. Your assignment of this week is read Ephesians and Colossians. That's going to deal with a lot of the issues that we are dealing with now. And this is what our children should know, be aware of. And our kids are warned to obey their parents and to obey those that have authority over them. So we're going to let y'all read, and y'all can be full of more discussion next week. Because we're talking about standing grace. How can we stand victoriously? And that is going to be only possible as we, what, get the word. All right, let's all stand and thank God for all of our visitors tonight. God,
we have a visitor right here.
Yes.
What year is it? I know people.
All right. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now, henceforth, and forever. Everybody say together, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let's go, man. Let's go.
How you doing?
Get your brother alive.